விண்ணாடும் தேவர்க்கும் மேலாய வேதியனை மண்ணாடும் மன்னவர்க்கும் மாண்பாகி நின்றானே தன்னார் தமிழடிக்கும் தன்பாண்டி நாட்டானே பெண்ணாடும் பாகனை பேணு பெருந்துறையில் கண்ணார் கடல் காட்டி நாகேனையார் கொண்ட அண்ணாமலையானை பாடுதுங்கா நம்மா நாய் ஸ்ரீ குருபியோ நமஹ. And it's a pleasure being a part of the Natyamrita Manthan 2020 organized by Dr. Lakshmi Ramaswamy and her disciples under the banner of Sri Mudralaya. And this year's concept being name, place, animal, thing, and the letter S being chosen. The topic that has been given to me is to talk about the place, Suchindram, that starts with an S. And to be more specific, it's about the art and architectural splendor of this beautiful ancient town called Suchindra. The town finds its reference from the Puranic era, and there is a very unique story which involves how the Trimurtis, Parameshwara, Mahavishnu and Brahma, all three of them got installed in one icon, all three together, and very popularly called as Sthanamalaya Swami, enshrined in the Sanctum Sanctorum. The temple is a huge campus with two corridors for pradakshinam, prominent ones, and several mandapas. Arguably, the location is, of course, in the southern part of Tamil Nadu, and the temple Gopuram is extremely photogenic and very popular. The development of the modern structure, the oldest historic record in this temple belongs to the time of Maranjadayan. It's around 9th century. And from then on, we have several inscriptions and interesting records as palm leaf manuscripts, temple records, manually written ones, all the way up until even the early 20th century to speak in volumes about the antiquity, origin, development and growth of this beautiful temple. So predominantly, almost all the monarchs that ruled the southern part of India seem to have contributed architecturally and have patronized the temple big time. Several new mandapas being added over years and new festivals being endowed up until the 20th century, the temple has been a very active and a happening one. So you had the early Pandyas and the Varmas, the Ramavarmas, the Venad kings, Cholas, the imperial and the later Cholas, followed by the later Pandyas, Vijayanagara, Madurai Nayaks, and the later monarchs of Travancore, the royal family. All of them have contributed in one way or the other to the temple's growth. It seems to be a fine example to understand architectural style specific to different periods. And the unique feature in the temple is a hillock, which is a part of the temple campus. In fact, the oldest inscription that I've been telling, and iconographically speaking, the Shivalingam in this small shrine, which is a sub-shrine today, which is very close to the Sanctum Sanctorum, seems to be the oldest structure there. And of course, there is this another unique structure called as Kondrai Adi Thanumalaya Swami. Kondrai being a traditional tree, which is the flowers of which is a favorite one, a chosen one for Lord Shiva. So as the tradition goes in any of these ancient temples, there is a particular tree that is chosen to be the temple tree, the Stala Vriksham as we call it. So here in this temple, it was Ashwatha Vriksham initially, and the next Yuga it was the Tulasi Vriksham, and then now it is the Tulasi plant, and now it is the Kondrai Maram. So Kondrai Adi Nadars or Kondrai Adi Thanumalaya Swami is another shrine just next to the Dvajastambha. So these two are like identified as early places of worship in the temple, followed by Thanumalaya Swami, which is more popularly the shrine, which is popularly called as Vadakkedam, and the one south on the southern direction to this called the Tekkedam or Thiruvengada Swami, that is the shrine for Mahavishnu. Apart from that, there are several dozens of shrines inside, big and small, simple and ornate, and several mandapas, each named after a king or the purpose that it is being used for. So that way, this is a classic example to understand periodic evolution in a temple and how it is easy to appreciate the architecture better if we get to know at least the specific features or special features that are specific to each of the ruling class. The main shrines are those of Shiva as Thanumalaya and Vishnu as Thiruvengada Vanan or Thiruvengada the Alvar, as he's called in the inscriptions. And there is also a shrine for Devi. She's called as Arambalartha Amman. And then there is a Nataraja Sabai called as Chitra Sabai with some paintings, not so old, but modern period paintings, and which also houses a Chitrapatam of Nataraja in the Sanctum Sanctorum, apart from a bronze icon of Nataraja and Shivakami. And there are other shrines for almost all gods possible in the Hindu pantheon. And the Gopuram, which is the most photographed part of the temple, it's just a splendor. The stucco work, though modern, it seems like it's just sprinkled all around the Gopuram. So it's a relatively modern structure. The stone part of it, the Kalaharam part, has been recorded in the inscription to have been worked upon in the 16th century, middle of 16th century. And there is an extensive renovation that has happened. Probably the times when all these beautiful stucco works that we see today were added was more from the 19th century. So that's like the most photographed part. The town otherwise is a quiet and calm town with a beautiful water tank just next to the temple. Complete town till date is temple centric and has some lovely streetscapes formed by beautiful traditional houses, most of which houses the temple employees. So altogether, a classic example to understand our temple-based settlement Suchindram town is. Let's get into the temple, and as we walk around, let's get to know about the development based on the architectural growth of the temple and the additions as it happened, which expanded the temple in all possible directions. That's a black and white picture. And thankfully, since then, this seems to be the most chosen angle to photograph this temple, with the Neerari Mandapam, which is also filled with rich stucco images, and the tall Gopuram, which, of course, I need to tell it again, but yeah, with stucco work seen everywhere. Yeah, so the tradition kind of continues. Over years, tourists are mostly taken towards this angle, which covers the Neerari Mandapam with the tank and the Gopuram. That's a very schematic plan of the temple. So I'll be using this plan as we move through the different zones inside the temple. For convenience, I've just split it into 5 or 6 zones. So each zone will be preceded by this map, and the highlighted area will show you as to what is the part of the temple that we are going to see as we walk in. So that's the Gopuram part that we're going to see. And this is the possible way through which we enter the temple. And Gopuram, as I told you, has been extensively renovated in the 19th century. So that construction, the base part of it is from 16th century. So the structure as such has existed at least for close to 400 odd years. So we walk in through this, and there are a few sub-shrines outside the temple dedicated to guardian deities, one for Ganesha and another for a guardian deity. And as we walk in, you have the service spaces, like space for the watchmen, the security space and other things. And then you walk straight through the Gopuram. That's the view from outside. And you can see the temple for the guardian deities here. And we walk in through this arch. This is the main entrance. And as you can see, the front face has 3 Sukhanasis, each housing Mahavishnu. From left to right, you have Mahavishnu on the Garuda Vahanam, Shiva and Parvati on the Rishabha Vahanam, and that's Ambal on the Hamsa Vahanam. So in all the processions, these are the 3 most prominent murtis that are brought out in different Vahanams. And all the processions start from this entrance of the temple. So let's walk in. So the core part of the temple is where the oldest structures are. And as you walk out from the Sanctum Sanctorum, you'll be traveling in time, probably from the oldest to the most modern structure as you walk out. Or when you walk from outside, you'll be traveling from a structure that was built in the recent past all the way up to the most ancient part of the temple. So these Yari Mandapams are very typically 18th century work, and we're just entering through that. You walk in, and this is the front portico-like structure, wherein the deities during procession are lined and then brought out all together. And this place, as I told you, serves as the cloakroom and security guards room and other things. The patrons from the most recent period, the images of the patrons are housed in this mandapam. As you can see, the dressing, jewelry, all that seen on the icons also makes up to helping us in identifying the period in which the construction was done. So you walk through this mandapam, the front mandapam, and that's when you get to see the Gopuram. The The Gopuram has been placed here after the pictures of the Mandapam, because the Gopuram is, as such, you will have to walk through that Mandapam to get close to the Gopuram. But the best way to appreciate the Gopuram is to zoom your cameras from outside. So you can see the stucco images. I'm not getting much into the stuccos because they're just there everywhere on the internet. But for a few classic examples that are there in the lower level, you have Mahasadashiva Murthy. He's Shiva basically. And there is the Kailasha Parvatam. And so all the multi-armed Shiva. Then this is the Amrita Manthan. So you see the Kurma Avatara Vishnu there. And that's Mahameru. And that's Dhanvantri, who's just coming out. And you have the Devas and Asuras, you know, on either sides, with Vasuki being the rope with which the Kshirasagaram is being churned out. And then almost the Gopuram has every probable deity that you can think about in the Hindu traditions. The stone part of it, the Kalharam part, as I told you, is a classic stamped Vijayanagara period contribution. So you have the sculptures that are very typically Vijayanagara, starting from Garuda. You can see the standard, the traditional part wherein you've got the pilasters here, and then each of this doubling up as a shrine. So all the features that goes in an actual life-size shrine are in here. So there are columns, the pilasters basically, that double up as columns, and every part of the column is in there. So you have the capital, you have the capital there, and you have the garbled part, the disc part, and the shaft. Everything is in there. The prastharam, which is here, with the kudu, and finally that's like the vimana part, and you have a another smaller form of the vimanam that's in there, and that's the space for the deity. So the complete first tier part of the stone base is filled with these smaller shrine-like structures which houses different deities, and on the eight corners, the four cardinal directions and the other in between the directions, you have the Ashtadik Balakas. This is Nirudhi on the southwest. So each of them with their respective weapons on their respective Vahanams. And as you walk in, you see scenes from wars, and that's like two warriors on their horses engaging in a fight with their swords. That's a very dramatic Trivikrama Murthy with Mahavishnu growing up. To the best of my knowledge, this is very close to the representation. I mean, the planning part of it is very close to the representation of Trivikrama in the Namakkal cave temple. I mean, everything, including even the dhoti frills and everything, is very similar to the Namakkal cave temple, but that's several centuries before this. Now that's Mahabali, Vamana taking the Danam, Shukracharya down with whatever is going to happen, knowing that this is Vishnu, he's already worried and he's sitting there. And you have all the devatas, celestials, witnessing in awe this grand event that's just happening, unfolding in front of their eyes. And they've also shown the cloud lines. A very dramatic Trivikrama panel, in fact. Followed by more deities. Skanda, Shiva as Uma Sahita, Shiva as Kankada Murthy. All of this is in the Gopuram part. That is Hari Ardha or Shankara Narayana with the god on one hand and the Shankar here. You can see the difference in the crown and the way they are equal half parts are dressed. You have the Pitambaram on one half, and that's the Shardula Sharmambaram. Chandra, Vishnu Durga with the deer and the lion. So that's just a few examples of the deities that you can see enshrined in the base part of the Gopuram. And you walk in. Lofty entrance, in fact, huge, and it is a sight to see grand and decorated, ornamented murtis coming out of these doors. And to the best of my knowledge, in almost all festivals in Suchindram, there are several deities that are brought out in each procession. And each of it has, every day is allotted to a different Puranic episode that is enacted by the deity. So it's like several deities who are a part of the procession. So you cross the Gopuram and you walk in to enter what is called as the Unjal Mandapam. It's a small court, and you'll have to cross this court, get into that grill gate that you see there, and that Mandapam is the Unjal Mandapam. Yeah, so that's about the Gopuram, and till this part we've seen, we are entering into the Unjal Mandapam, followed by the Dvajastambha Mandapam, Dvajastambham and the other shrines that are there, and then this narrow corridor here called as Aditya Mandapam, the entrance. This is the Unjal Mandapam, a very clear 17th century Nayak period structure, which has this identical colossal statue, monolithic statue, which is there in the corner pillars in all four directions. So this is the complete mandapam. So there is Rati Devi here, and there are two other characters on the western side, and one more on the southeastern corner. So that's like four icons, monolithic ones in four corners. A close-up of Rati Devi. You can recall similar structures in several of these Madurai Nayak style temples, like Tirunelveli Nalayappar temple, Srivilliputtur Andad, Sri Vaikuntham Perumal temple, and of course the Madurai Meenakshi temple. And the traditional Nayak grandeur is exhibited by managing to pierce a hole which kind of connects the ears, both the ears. So you pierce one ear with a small thin rope or a string, it just comes out through the other ears. This is again very similar. In fact, in Madurai, you can recall how one of the Devi's icon has a small pierced hole in her nose through which her nose stud can actually be inserted there. That's Manmada on the other end with the Pushpabhanam and the Ikshudandam there, the sugarcane burr and the arrow made up of a flower bouquet. And the other side. So very typical Madurai Nayak style mandapam is the Unjal Mandapam. And just after the Unjal Mandapam is what this very narrow, crisp corridor. That's the width of the corridor, as you can see. So the purpose of this corridor is to house two Dvajastambhams, one each for Sthanumalaya and Mahavishnu. There are two Dvajastambhams, which means there will be two Vahana Mandapams, one for Nandi and the other for Garuda Advar. This is called the Aditya Mandapam or Aditya Varman Mandapam, arguably from the 15th century. This is Kondragadi Thanumalayan shrine. So again, rear part of the Dvajastambha Mandapam, which has Dakshinamurti shrine and that of shrines of Nandi and Garuda, all belongs to Tirumalai Nayakar's period. Very again, typical, you can again recall similar, very intricate carved small structures or mandapas in Srivilliputtur and other towns. So probably this was the small stage where the Kondrai Maram stood, which was worshipped in the initial stages as the temple evolved. So to honor it, the shrine is still there. And inside the shrine is a gold masked murti of Sthanumalaya. That's Trimurti Aikya Tattvam with Shiva in the center and Vishnu and Brahma. Again, this the other more popular Shaivite interpretation is about how from Shiva, Brahma and Vishnu emerge out. So that's the murti that's enshrined inside the Kondragadi Sthanumalayan Sannidhi. And to the south of this shrine is a very small shrine for Dakshinamurti. Though the murti is ancient, the shrine is again from Tirumalai Nayaka's time. That's the Dvajastambha Mandapam, followed by the shrine for Nandi and Garuda Alvar. While the Garuda Alvar's Mandapam is very typically Tirumalai Nayaka's time, with the portrait image of Tirumalai Nayaka in one of the columns, and the iconography of Garuda is also very clearly from the Madurai Nayak period. But the Nandi's image, there is an inscription which refers to a donation made for burning a perpetual lamp to the Nandi here. So again, probably renovated more during Tirumalai Nayak's time. This is a stucco image. So this is the Unjal Mandapam that we saw, which had Rati and Manmadan. This is Kondragadi Nadan shrine with the Dakshinamurti shrine and Garuda Alvar and Nandi. So one straight line from Nandi, that's the shrine of Thanumalaya Swami. And from Garuda, this is the shrine of Mahavishnu as Trivenkatanatha. Next, we are entering into the most grand and huge part of the temple, we are welcomed by a pair of very classic the Marthanda Varma time Dwarapalakas, and this is by Rama Marthanda Varma from the 15th century, or the surname for him, he is identified more popularly as Champakaraman or Shenbakaraman. So this mandapam is called as Champakaraman mandapam. So this is split into three aisles with four colonnades, that's series of rows of columns, four rows of columns, and the central aisle is widest and grand, and it gives a very beautiful perspective, grand perspective as you walk in. Yeah, so that's where Dhwajastambham is. So technically, this is Tirumalai Nayaka's Vahana Mandapam with Nandi and Garuda. This small corridor, which just houses the Dhwajastambhams, the pair of Dhwajastambhams and the Balipedam, is the Rama Varma's, is the Aditya Varma's Mandapam, followed by Shenbakaraman Mandapam, built during the 15th century. So this has very typical period, the Marthanda Varma period construction, with the Kudu becoming very dominant and a perfect semicircle, in fact, and depiction of the timber pilasters, all that in stone happens here. And you have the Prastara part, which gets down. A side view from the northern Prakara. This is how grand it is. Just too good, with some beautiful paintings. Of course, very modern enamel paintings, but they've at least retained the old designs that were from traditional artists. So that's how grand it looks. Again, you can see similar mandapas in several of those shrines in South India. So these are all from the 15th century, the Varma's, Marthanda Varma's shrine. And right in front of this mandapam is a Ganesha shrine. Ganesha there himself is called as Marthanda Vinayakar. And there are other Ganeshas like Indra Vinayakar. And so there are several Ganesha shrines inside. The musical columns in the western end of this shrine. So as you walk down the Champakaraman Mandapam, you get close to the Sanctum Sanctorum on the western side, and to the northern side of the end is where the cluster of musical columns are there. So this is more popularly called as the Sabha Mandapam, which has the musical columns. Now, of course, people are discouraged from touching it because, you know, we need to safeguard it. So during special occasions and almost in the evening times, you have one lamp lit for each of the column. Imagine no electrical lamps and how beautiful it would have looked with just these deepams that are are being lit there. And right in the center is is a nice ornate raised platform on which another very classical colonial style throne is kept. The deity is brought out during special occasions and he's kept there more like a darbar. This is the second aisle which leads you to the Vishnu shrine. There are very typical Vijayanagara period columns in the sides of Shenbakaraman Mandapam, which has again stamped Vijayanagara period ornamentation. More of the Shenbakaraman Mandapam, the sides. And on the Satan corridor, the South Prakaram, just abutting Shenbakaraman's Mandapam is what is called as the Vasanta Mandapam. So this is also from the 17th century, but the ornamentation is very classical. Without informing that it is a 17th century structure, and if someone just shows you this part of the column, a photograph of this part of the column, there is all good possibility of mistaking it to belong to an earlier period. So this is used during the Vasanta Utsavam, with the deity being installed here, and this space here filled with water. Very ornate mandapam, again from the Varma period. And the roof part of it, the ceiling part of it, is split into nine squares, a 3x3 matrix, with all the nine grahas, the Navagrahas, being enshrined in there. So colloquially, it is also called as the Navagraha Vasanta Mandapam. That's technically might not sound a good name, but yeah, that's how people refer to it. And you have the patterns enshrined on the columns. That's a close-up of the grand column. So we finish the Vasantotsava Mandapam and get closer to the Sanctum Sanctorum. This is the Tekkedam, or the southern quarters, and the Vadakkedam. So the one more to the north is the shrine for Sthanumalaya, and one south to it, Tekkedam, is the shrine for Mahavishnu. That's the space right outside Sthanamalayan's shrine. So these are like the oldest structure, arguably around the 10th century, because the architectural features, though there are no direct inscriptional evidences to say that the Sanctum Sanctorum of Sthanamalaya and Mahavishnu are from the 10th century, architectural features are the second possible options for us to go through to understand the period, to assign a period. This is the space outside the Thekkedam or the court outside Vishnu's shrine. You can see the ornamentation is very minimum and the capitals are very typically from the early Chola phase. That's the side wall of the Sanctum Sanctorum. As you can see, they've gone in for a semicircular arch pattern there. And even the niches, the external niches or the koshtas, they've not even created the koshtas. And the pilasters are there without much of an ornamentation. So you can see that the upapeetam is also not there. So the raised plinth part is not there. So these are the standard features which we use to identify or assign a tentative time period to the structure. This is the northern side. So all these caged columns on all four corners, those are the musical pillars. The Sabha Mandapam, as it is called. And the rear part of it is the shrine of Subramanya. So again, the Garbhagraham and the Murti and all that belongs to the 15th century. Extended portico is from the 16th century. This space that you see here, which is like the end of the Vadakedam, is what is called as Veerapandiyan Mandapam. Again, from around the mids of 14th century, that has the that's more like the space where the bells, the temple bells are tied to the ceiling, and during special occasions, I mean during the puja, the ritual period, it's used. So that's the Veerapandiyan Mandapam, Vadakedam. This is the court where we saw devotees waiting in the previous photograph, and this is the shrine of Sthanamalaya. This is the shrine of Mahavishnu as Trivengadanatha. Now we are going to the extreme other end, arguably the oldest part of the temple. So when you at the far end of the Shanbhagaraman Mandapam, you have a small entrance where you'll have to climb a few steps to get down on the other direction, because that's where you have the shrine of Kankalanatha. And the icon in here and the Sanctum Sanctorum again is from the 12th century Chola period, but there are two porticos, where one where with the Nandi inside and the next here. So this is from a modern period, and these two women holding the lamps do not belong to this column. They are from somewhere else. There are several corridors with columns each showing a woman holding a lamp that can be lit. So these are abandoned sculptures that they have found refuge here. But for that, this Mandapam is a very, very modern structure, probably built in the last 200 years. And the Mandapam next to it should be, say, 300 years old. That's it. The Vimanam has been extensively reworked. So that by itself is a clue that this shrine of Kankalanatha has been worked upon several times. That's the corridor, the first prakaram around the Sanctum Sanctorum. Right behind the shrine of Sthanamalaya. That's the entrance for Kailasanatha's shrine. Even starting from the inscriptions, the oldest inscription all refers to this deity as Kailasa Mudayar, and there is a small Shivalingam that's enshrined, an ancient one, in fact, at least from the 9th or the 10th century. But the sanctum space, the shrine for the Shivalingam has been extensively reworked around the 13th century. That's roughly during the later Chola phase. So that's on an elevated plane. So you can see how, when you reach the floor level of Kailasa Mudayar's shrine, the roof of the rest of the temple is actually visible. So that will give you an idea about how tall you'll have to climb up. So that's just abutting the Madapalli or the temple kitchen space. You can see the chimney is there. The shrine of Kailasa Mudayar. And he is facing perfect west. So you can see the small hillock inside, which you will have to climb to get into the shrine. So Sthanamalaya Swami is facing east and the Kailasa Mudayar is facing west. So Kondraiyadi Sthanamalayan, followed by Kailasa Mudayar, followed by the Sthanamalayan's shrine today. That's probably should have been the order in which the shrine has developed. The path to come out, the access Mandapa is in fact beautifully crafted, and this is again from the 15th century, the Varma period, the Martanda Varma's period. So you can recall the similarity between this and the Shanbhagaraman Mandapam that we saw previously. So these are like replica of the purlins and rafters that are used in timber construction. You can see a grid that is formed, the structural grid that is formed with wooden logs that run vertical and horizontal. So these are like stone replica of it. And in some cases, they even show struts and bolts and steel rods that runs through. That's like the central skeletal crib that holds the roof tiles on top, but they just replicated with in stone. A very ornate part, and even the kudu part is very similar to what we saw in the Shanbhagaraman Mandapa. The external part, more from the 13th century, that's like the end of the Cholas period. So that's the rocky terrain that you see inside the temple. So they have brought in a compound wall to house the shrines of Thanumalaya and Trivengadanatha. And just outside the compound wall is the shrine for Kailasamudayar. And this is the first corridor. The rock has inscriptions from the period of Rajaraja the Great. So this again is a clue that the temple here, before it was converted into a stone structure as we see today in the later Chola period, should have existed as a brick structure. Now that is understood by a fact that the inscriptions cannot be inscribed on brick walls. So in the ancient period, when stone construction hasn't become popular, the other alternative to get the inscriptions done were stone beds that were in close proximity to the structure. So this is another thing that we see in several ancient brick structures or brick structures that were later converted into stone structures. So the early inscriptions will all be on the stone surface that is available anywhere close by. And that it is an uneven surface on which the inscription has got to be chiseled out. The general tradition again is to draw these guidelines. Else, you know, imagine writing on an uneven surface, there is a possibility of the inscription line going, not being parallel. And these are official records. So the best possible way is to have your guidelines in place and then scribe the words. The corridors, these are all from the Marthanda Varma period again. So you can see the complete corridor, which is filled on either sides with columns, all in equal height. And each of the column has an image of a woman holding a lamp in her hand. These are actual lamps which will be lit. The Vimanas, as seen from the outside. Thanumalaya Swami's Vimana is close to, Vimana as in from the ground level, all the way including the superstructure till the Kalasam is close to 35 feet, huge in fact, and that of Mahavishnu's is 20 feet. This is from the western corridor, so you can see the Gopuram, the eastern end of the temple. So we're just circumambulating the shrine. The northern corridor, we've just turned into the northern corridor and walking. So complete south, west and the north corridors have the similar columns. Now we just finish the Sri Balipura or the corridor here, the northern corridor, and we are coming to the second popularly photographed image in the temple, which is the colossal image of Hanuman. Now you can see him as a part of the corridor, and there are several legends that involves him, and the fact that he was discovered when there were some extensions happening in the temple in the recent past, when they were digging and they chanced upon this gigantic murti of Hanuman and got him enshrined here. And there are very beautiful and wonderful decorations that are done with different materials like butter and sandal paste and more. Just next to Hanuman's shrine is what is called as the Chitra Sabhai. The Chitra Sabhai is a nice art gallery, literally translated, it's an art gallery which houses the Nataraja shrine. So obviously the Sabhai is facing the south, that's the tradition. And it has a pair of elephants in the front entrance with steps that takes you in. And these are again from the late Nayak period. As again, you can see the statues, the sculptures that are the column height. That's Krishna as Venugopala on one side, and that's Shiva as Kankadanatha on the other. They welcome you as you walk in. That's the Vimanam of the Sabhai. Inside the Sabhai, you have Kali and other deities, and you can see very modern enamel paintings Probably it had traditional paintings, I'm not sure. But today it's all only enamel paintings depicting Shiva and different Karanas. That's the Sanctum Sanctorum. It has an antique painting, Tanjore painting of Nataraja and Shivakami, along with all other devotees, which are generally a part of the Nataraja panel, like Patanjali, Vyakrapada, and Bringi, Karekalamayar, and everybody in there. Then there is arguably one of those old bronze images in the temple. That's the stage in the Sabha Mandapam, the Chitra Sabai. That's the actual Sabai, which houses the image of Nataraja inside. And as the tradition goes, for all the Abhishekams, the Utsava Murthy is brought out and kept in this platform, the pedestal, and the Abhishekam is performed. That's with the temple architecture part of it. Just did a small virtual tour to understand different phased development of the temple. The other Utsava Murthys include Uma Sahita Murthy, but there is an interesting inscription, of course, from the 15th century, which speaks about donation of a Somaskanda Murthy to the temple. But today, the processional deity, the main processional deity, is a silver image of Uma Sahita. That's Skanda. And about the paintings, there are two phases of paintings. One, what you see now, is from the modern era. That's Saraswati, and that's Anusuya, Indra, and more antique of antique period is what you see as panels depicting Ramayana. So all the episodes of Ramayana, different episodes of Ramayana is depicted in here. Now Ramayana, as we all know, in the Kerala mural style, is a very popular theme with which they've decorated their temple and palace walls. That's Anantapadmanabha. Krishna with Yashoda. Ramavataram. Ramaravana Yuddham. That's Hanuman handing over Sita's ring to Rama. Sabari Moksham. That's with the paintings in there. So a very unique temple, which, as I told you, spans through at least a recorded history of 1,300 odd years. So if it had been popular 1,300 years back, you can imagine how ancient it should be. It should have been celebrated for several centuries even before that. So, for the fact that it is unique, starting from traditions, the Puranic episodes that are associated with the temple and more, it just needs to be celebrated and an understood and appreciated temple of South India. I'm finishing the lecture quoting Jnanasambandhar Thevaram on Thiruvili Midalai, where he calls out Thanumalayan by name. Kanumar Ariya Perumalahi, Kalamai Gunangal Moonrai, Pen Moonruruahi, Perulaham Padai Tadikum Peruman Koil, Tanuvai, Nindra Paratatuvanai, Uttamanai, Irenjir, Yendri, Vernuvar Kodi Vinnor, Tamai Vilipa, Polong Midalai Ame. It's on Thiruvili Midalai, where there is a reference to how Parameshwara has Shiva and Brahma within him, and so this Swarupam of Shiva is Thanumalaya. Of course, the name of Thanu alone is being referred to here. And Padaitu Alikkum Peruman is, of course, him, wherein all the three gods have gotten into one form. So that's a very brief discussion on the architecture of the temple and how it is developed over several centuries. To recall once again, starts the earliest record from Maranjadayan's period. It's from the 9th century. And in fact, there is a reference from in Sri K.K. Pillai's thesis, the doctorate thesis, that which is on Suchindram, a very fantastic documentation, in fact an extensive documentation and a model work for a doctoral research thesis, in fact. So that gives us a lot of information on inscriptions and more, wherein he mentions a fragmentary inscription which is dated to the 7th century inside the Madapalli, and several inscriptions which predates Maranjadayan's have been defaced. Part of them have been hidden because of modern additions that have happened over years. So certainly the temple has been a happening, patronized, well-visited, popular temple at least for close to 1,500 or 600 years period. And so a classic example to understand the evolution of temple architecture, starting from something as rudimentary as the Kailashanatha shrine on a small hillock, which is later developed into a properly built later Chola period structure. From there on, the unique design, which was followed by the Marthanda Varmas in the 16th, 17th and 18th centuries, and by the later Travancore royal family, and of course the Pandyan, Vijayanagara and the Nayak period. So you have everything for almost a good 1,000-year-old evolution of temple architecture, which you can understand through very critical and classic examples when you visit Suchindra. I thank the organization and specifically the organizers of this beautiful conference, which has shifted to online this year, and the enthusiasm and the professionalism with which the complete program was charted out, and from topic allocation to promotions and everything. It was extremely professional, and it was a delight working with this team in here. And thank you, and to extend your support to all the other lectures that are going to be a part of the Natyamrita Manthan. Murthi Ellam Vaazhi, Engal Mona Guru Vaazhi, Arul Vaartha Endrum Vaazhi, Anbar Vaazhi Parabarame. Ellam Shri Tyagaraja Kripai, Shri Tyagaraja Maharajo Vijayate, Arura Tyagesa. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.